Item number, SCP-008. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-008 samples have been deemed Class 5 extreme biological hazards, and all related protocols apply. Incineration and irradiation measures will be deployed in the event of political or military action, which may result in the facility being dismantled, a power failure, or zero communications from operatives or outside channels during any given 8-hour period. The quarantine period for operatives leaving the facility is 4 months. If a breach has occurred, incineration and irradiation measures shall be deployed. It should be the policy of all G2 sites to not prepare an evacuation procedure. Description: SCP-008 is a complex prion, samples of which are stored in each of the known G2 sites. Research into SCP-008 is highly classified, and primarily aimed at preventing research which may lead to the synthesis of SCP-008 in the distant future. Traits of the SCP-008 prion include 100% infectiousness, 100% lethality, transmission through exposed mucous membranes and all bodily fluids, not airborne or waterborne. Symptoms of infection with SCP-008 manifest no more than 3 hours after exposure, and include flu-like symptoms with high fever plus severe dementia in later stages, coma onset approximately 20 hours after first symptoms appear, and 12 hours after noticeable dementia. Coma onset will be considered onset of death. A period of sporadic cellular necrosis occurs, which comes to resemble gangrene. Surviving tissue assumes its original function and is highly resilient. Red blood cells greatly increase oxygen storage capacity, resulting in slower blood flow and increased muscle endurance and strength. Nervous and muscular systems are unaffected by total organ failure for several hours. Metabolism may decrease to extremely low levels, allowing subject to survive for over 10 years without nutrition. High blood viscosity results in negligible blood flow from gunshot, puncture, and slashing injuries. Conditioned behavior, motor controls, and instinctive behavioral mechanisms are damaged, and cognitive abilities are severely retarded and erratic. Animals experience excessive brain necrosis and are inactive. Subject can adapt to its damaged nervous systems but is limited to basic physical activities, including standing up, balancing on two legs, walking, biting, grabbing, and crawling. Subject will energetically move towards sights, sounds, and smells it associates with living humans. Subject will attempt to ingest living humans if physical contact is made. Neutralizing fully infected subjects requires significant cranial trauma. There is strong evidence to suggest SCP-008 itself did not form naturally on Earth, since variants of similar complexity would have displaced much of the ecosystem. In 1959, a short collaborative effort with the USSR to locate G2 sites and eliminate SCP-008 was negotiated following their discovery. The status of SCP-008 in Russian custody since collaboration ended is unknown. Addendum 008-1, SCP-500 has been found to be able to completely cure SCP-008, even in the advanced stages of the disease. Item number, SCP-16. Object class, Keter. Special containment procedures. SCP-16 is to remain within the confines of a 5x5x5 meter room at all times, maintained at a temperature not to exceed 0 degrees Celsius. SCP-16 itself is to remain in the petri dish in the containment cube at all times, unless directed otherwise by Level 4 or O5 personnel. Full documentation of experimentation with SCP-16 must be submitted before and after samples and duplicates of SCP-16 may be taken. Failure to follow these procedures will result in termination or reassignment as Class D personnel. Only authorized personnel may be permitted to obtain samples of and experiment with SCP-16 under BCL-5 containment conditions. If an outbreak does occur, despite following the aforementioned procedures, directive-based personnel are to implement a Code Sigma lockdown and containment plan. Infected personnel are to be terminated on site by security forces wearing standard mission-oriented protective posture, or MOPP, anti-biological and anti-chemical equipment. Should the infection not be contained after 48 hours, the on-site nuclear device is to be detonated. Remaining personnel are not to be evacuated under any circumstances. SCP-16 has been shown to survive for up to 6 hours on hard surfaces, and up to several minutes in air. High-intensity ultraviolet light and high concentrations of orthophthalaldehyde solution have been demonstrated to be effective in disinfecting non-organic surfaces. Description: SCP-16 is a blood-borne pathogen recovered from a mine worker and who injured himself while working in a deep coal seam. Said wound became contaminated with coal dust from the mine, possibly infecting the worker with dormant spores. Over the next several days, SCP-16 proceeded to infect the remaining employees at the mining camp, as well as the CDC crisis team dispatched to deal with the epidemic. Foundation personnel then took over the investigation and terminated all affected personnel. Patient Zero was brought into captivity, and the mine shaft was collapsed by an explosive device. SCP-16 has an incubation period ranging from 24 hours to 2 years, depending on the presence and number of other human hosts in the area. First symptoms resemble the common cold and include itchy eyes, runny nose, coughing, and bodily aches. Phase 2 begins in 48 hours and consists of a controlled form of hemorrhagic fever, as the organism causes a small amount of blood to become aspirated in the lungs, creating an aerosol effect. During Phase 3, the host crashes and bleeds out, bleeding profusely from every bodily orifice, including the nose, tear ducts, anus, skin pores, mouth, urethra, and in case of females, vagina. Blood pressure skyrockets during the final stage. Hosts have been observed projectile vomiting blood to distances of over 5 meters. Should the host survive this near-total exsanguination, the pathogen will become dormant once more, returning to incubation phase. What distinguishes SCP-16 from other strains of hemorrhagic fever, such as Ebola and Marburg, is its unusual response to high stress. Should the subject undergo a high-stress situation, such as a life-threatening crisis, the organism will change its survival tactic from rapid reproduction to the rewriting of the host's DNA and stimulation of rapid cell division. Major physiological changes occur within the first 24 hours, with complete bodily reconstruction occurring within 2 weeks' time. Most hosts do not survive the process due to the heavy demands made on the body. Due to their similarities as fatal contagions that stimulate the production of excess organs, a possible link to SCP-1801 is under investigation. An interesting side effect of the transformation is an increased aggressive urge. It is believed that this may be an attempt to maximize the spread of the virus in a manner similar to rabies. On another note, subjects who undergo bodily transformation no longer appear to exhibit SCP-16's hemorrhagic properties. However, subjects infected by transformed hosts will still undergo the normal SCP-16 infection process. Addendum: Experiment Log of SCP-16's Transformative Properties. Subject D-16-1. D-class personnel infected by SCP-16. Upon first showing symptoms, subjects' quarters were slowly flooded with water over a 24-hour period. SCP-16 mutated into a teratomorphic state, transforming subjects' lungs into gills. Subjects survived for 2 more weeks as SCP-16 transformed its limbs into fins, caused its eyes to atrophy, and enhanced its sense of hearing into a Cetacean-type echolocation ability. Subject was terminated by draining all water from its quarters, causing it to asphyxiate. Body was subsequently cremated without autopsy. Subject D-16-2, D-class personnel infected by SCP-16. Upon first showing symptoms, subject's quarters were slowly flooded with water over a 24-hour period. SCP-16 mutated into a teratomorphic state, causing subject to undergo rapid muscular growth and increased bone growth on knuckles. Subject then attempted to escape from confinement by punching through the reinforced steel door. Subject was not successful and died by drowning. Note: same situation, two different responses. Interesting. Dr. Subject D-16-3, D-Class personnel infected by SCP-16. Subject was previously a chemical engineer who poisoned his wife upon discovering her adultery. Upon first showing symptoms, subject's quarters were slowly flooded with water over a 24-hour period. SCP-16 mutated into a teratomorphic state, causing subject to grow an unusual organ on his chest, consisting of a chamber and two separate tubes. Organ continued to take in water and swell in size, until Foundation personnel, realizing what SCP-16 may be attempting, terminated the subject by gunshot. Organ was found to contain several gas sacs filled with acetylene gas and oxygen. Subject D-16-4, D-Class personnel infected by SCP-16. Subject was told to concentrate on forming wings. No stress was applied. SCP-16 did not mutate into teratomorphic state. Subject died of exsanguination during Phase 3. Subject D-16-5, D-Class personnel infected by SCP-16. Subject was told to concentrate on forming wings and placed in an acrylic box suspended 305 meters or 1,000 feet above a mine shaft. A timer was placed outside the box, which subject was told indicated the time to release. SCP-16 mutated into teratomorphic state, causing subject to grow a tentacle-like organ on his left wrist similar to a spider's spinnerets. Subject extended said organ through one of the box's air holes and extruded a strong, silk-like substance, which it then used to secure the box to the cable. Subject was terminated when the countdown reached zero, and the bomb detonated. Item number, SCP-10. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. The objects comprising SCP-10 are to be kept in numbered locked boxes in a high-security facility. They are not to be worn except by test subjects. SCP-10 are only to be removed from storage for testing. Description: SCP-10 consists of a series of six apparently identical cast iron collars with numbered metal tags and one remote control. The control is SCP-10-1. The collars are SCP-10-2 through 10-7. The collars contain intricate electronic components and are powered by small, 5mm in diameter, 2mm thick 100-volt batteries. These batteries are rechargeable. The remote is a heavy black box, resembling an old-style handheld radio transmitter receiver with a primitive blue and white cathode ray screen and a series of more than 100 unlabeled buttons, as well as a frequency tuner. Through trial and error, the frequencies of all six currently found collars have been discovered. A label in Russian is stamped into the metal, along with a logo consisting of workers building a pyramid. No official Russian corporation or government agency uses this logo, or matches the words stamped into the metal. Placing the collar around the neck of a person and securing it allows one to control their every movement with the remote. It is also capable of producing an adrenal response and activating or deactivating the sympathetic nervous system. The most abnormal feature of the collars is the effect they have on the body morphology. They allow the user of the remote to reconfigure the shape of the victim to an extent that is apparently only limited by the knowledge of the programming language of the remote. Addendum 10-1, History. SCP-10 was discovered in the basement of a lone man in the Midwestern United States after a local disappearance was connected to him. When the police raided the man's house, they found SCP-10, as well as several dead bodies. One of the bodies was identified to be the man. The others were several other missing persons. Cause of death seemed to be mass suicide. However, there were signs of significant struggle first. Addendum 10-2. Disassemble experiment. Test 1. SCP-10-2 taken apart piecewise. The parts labeled and several photographs taken, then reassembled. Result: after reassembly, SCP-10-2 continues to function. Test 2. SCP-10-8 constructed identically to SCP-10-2, but with the closest approximations available to the unreplicable components. Result: SCP-10-8 fails to function. Test 3. Unreplicable components from SCP-10-2 placed into proper locations on SCP-10-8. Result: SCP-10-2 ceases functioning with removal of components. SCP-10-8 begins functioning. Test 4. Components returned to SCP-10-2. Replicable components in SCP-10-2 replaced randomly with replicas. Result: SCP-10-2 begins functioning with return of components. Changing replicable components for replicas does not significantly reduce functionality. Replacement of a damaged transistor decreased time from transmission to effect of SCP-10-2, response to commands entered in the remote, by 12%. Addendum 10-3. SCP-10 has been demonstrated to work more effectively in creating unskilled labor than for any other task. The logo is apt. Dr. Item number: SCP-021. Object class: safe. Special containment procedures. SCP-021 is an obligate parasite of the human body. Containment, therefore, is no more difficult than containing an adult human. Most cells will suffice. Item is currently housed in detention cell 217A on subject D-139. Only Class D personnel are eligible for hosting SCP-021. As long as a given subject survives as a host for SCP-021, he is exempt from normal monthly terminations of Class D personnel. Description: SCP-021 takes the form of a large and elaborate tattoo of a serpentine dragon in the Oriental style, covering approximately 0.8 meters squared of skin. This tattoo is fully animate within the confines of its host's skin, and behaves largely as a normal animal would, albeit in only two dimensions. The tattoo's movement causes constant pain to its host, comparable and similar in character to simultaneous tattooing and tattoo removal on a large scale. The organism tends to spend most of its time on and near the torso. SCP-021 displays no intelligence beyond a basic pattern of feeding and locomotion, although actually measuring the intelligence of a two-dimensional life form has proven impossible thus far. SCP-021 appears to feed exclusively on pigments in the host's skin. This can include melanin, in which case the subject appears to be suffering from vitiligo. However, the organism shows a marked preference for other tattoos, and will seek out and devour these before resorting to natural pigments. It should be noted that the feeding process itself, beyond the sensation of movement, is painless. Normal tattoo ink simply vanishes as it is eaten. The organism maintains a constant size, and no excretions have been observed. The organism is capable of clearing over 0.6 meters squared of skin per hour. One may feed SCP-021 by quickly tattooing fruits or small animals on the host. SCP-021 can be transferred between hosts by various forms of physical contact, with differing rates of success. In the case of successful transfer, the organism simply swims from one person to the other. Sexual intercourse appears to be the most reliable method of transfer, with a 93% rate of transmission. However, due to the severe pain involved, this is less than ideal. Contact between two open wounds is generally preferable. Transfer is more complicated in deceased subjects, though not unreasonably so. The organism suffers no ill effects from the death of its host, and continues to consume pigments. Transmission between species is unknown. Previous tests suggest it to be either impossible or exceedingly rare. SCP-021 does confer some benefits to its host. The tattoo has been proven to accelerate the release and reuptake of epinephrine and decrease lactic acid buildup, providing boosts of strength, confidence, and pain tolerance in stressful situations, and reducing the usual after effects of weakness and fatigue. In addition, the tattoo seems to have some beneficial effect on the host's immune system. Aggression profiles in hosts are generally higher than average, though whether this is a direct effect of the tattoo or simply a reaction to the constant pain remains to be seen. The symbiotic relationship is usually limited by how long the host can tolerate such pain in everyday life. This has culminated in suicide in a number of subjects. In rare cases, hosts have also fallen victim to fatal skin infections. SCP-021's origins and nature are a mystery. Tracing its transmission from host to host is hardly feasible within the confines of secrecy, and the organism could well be hundreds of years old, if not more. Nevertheless, SCP-021's captivity is one of the longest in the Foundation's history, at nearly data-expunged years. and has been very educational thus far. Current research focuses mainly on observing the characteristics of life in two dimensions. Item number, SCP-034. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. SCP-034 is to be kept in a secure room, with access granted only to level 4 personnel. SCP-034 itself will be kept in a locked case that is under 24-hour surveillance. When not in lab conditions, SCP-034's protective sheath cannot be removed under any circumstances. Any personnel in contact with SCP-034 must be placed under a 24-hour observation period until their identities can be confirmed. Description: SCP-034 is a primitive knife constructed out of pure obsidian. Tests reveal that SCP-034 is approximately 1,000 years old. Despite its crude method of construction and age, SCP-034 is still incredibly sharp and requires no maintenance to retain its edge. Expert analysis hypothesizes that SCP-034 may be of South American origin, and that it may have been used in Native American rituals. Several accounts from Spanish conquistadors exploring the region support this hypothesis, with detailed writings on how priests would flay their victims alive with similar knives and wear their skin as a tribute to their gods. SCP-034 has the ability to allow its bearer to take on the appearance of another individual. If SCP-034 is used to cut a piece of flesh from a living individual, and that piece of flesh is placed against the skin of another individual, the second individual would take on not only the appearance, but all physical characteristics of the first individual. Testing has shown that the minimum amount of skin required can be as little as 1 square centimeter. However, testing has also revealed that the amount of time the transformation lasts is directly proportional to the amount of flesh used. The ratio of time the transformation lasts to flesh used has been measured at approximately 1 hour for every square centimeter used. Once the time limit is passed, the affected individual will revert to their original form. Analysis of SCP-034's ability shows that its method of mimicking another individual is nearly flawless. Not only does SCP-034 change its bearer's physical appearance, but their actual physical attributes as well, including height, weight, muscle mass, bone density, hair growth, eyesight, strength, physical medical conditions, and even DNA. The only physical traits that are not carried over in the transformation process are wounds caused by SCP-034 itself. Subjects still retain their original personality and memories while transformed. Even though the process is nearly instantaneous, taking only a few seconds, human test subjects have described the transformation process as extremely painful. Subjects also may suffer psychological trauma, depending on the extent of their physical transformation. Side effects are especially serious if the subject takes on the appearance of a person with differing gender, or with wildly different physical attributes. However, in order to function properly, the individuals who have their flesh cut off by SCP-034 must still be biologically alive to maintain the transformation. Should the individual whose identity has been stolen expire, the effect immediately wears off. Further details may be found in Lab Report 034A. Also, SCP-034 only appears to work on human subjects. Cross-species experiments with SCP-034 have resulted in data expunged. SCP-034 came into Foundation possession when an imposter disguised as Dr. attempted to infiltrate Site. The imposter was apprehended when authorities discovered the real Dr. tied up in his home, with a large portion of his right arm skinned. Further details may be found in Post-Interrogation Report 2211. Lab Report 034A. We've decided to test several scenarios, dealing with the limits of SCP-034's capabilities. Test 1. Sample taken from deceased human cadaver, and applied to subject D-452. There is no observable effect. Test 2. Sample taken from D-532, and applied to D-452. D-452 successfully mimics D-532's appearance. Upon termination of D-532, D-452 immediately reverts back to original form. Test 3. Sample taken from D-433 while under a medically induced coma, and applied to subject D-452. D-452 successfully mimics D-433's appearance and manages to maintain the transformation and consciousness. Test 4. Sample taken from a brain-dead medical patient who suffered a massive brain hemorrhage and applied to D-452. D-452 successfully mimics the patient's appearance, but immediately loses consciousness upon transformation. D-452 does not regain consciousness until the transformation period expires. D-452 retains no memory of the event. Test 5. Sample taken from D-625, who suffered a broken arm due to a confrontation with security staff. D-452 successfully mimics D-625's appearance, including the broken arm. D-452's broken arm is remended when the transformation period expires. Test 6. Sample taken from a terminally ill medical patient and applied to D-452. The patient's terminal illness was caused by an inherent genetic defect. D-452 successfully mimics the patient's appearance, as well as the patient's illness. Both the terminally ill patient and D-452 expire at the same time, after which D-452 reverts back to original form. Test 7. Sample taken from a chimpanzee and applied to D-466. D-466 experiences rapid growth of hair across their entire body. There are otherwise no other significant physical or physiological changes. Body hair disappears when the transformation period expires. Test 8. Sample taken from an Atlantic salmon and applied to D-466. There is no observable effect. Test 9. Under O5 authorization, a sample taken from SCP is applied to D-466. D-466 exhibits extremely adverse reaction upon transformation and data expunged, resulting in significant damage to testing environment, multiple injuries among test and security staff, and the death of D-466. Testing of anomalous humanoids with SCP-034 is suspended indefinitely. Post-interrogation report 2211. As per standard operating procedure, we first attempted to interrogate the prisoner via non-violent and non-invasive means. However, when such methods proved ineffective, we began to implement conventional interrogation techniques. While partially successful, we deemed it necessary to use SCP. We managed to learn the following facts. The prisoner had extensive knowledge on the existence of the Foundation and its inner workings. The prisoner had extensive knowledge on other SCP-related agencies and groups. The prisoner was not acting under any official capacity from any government agency. The prisoner obtained SCP-034 and instructions on its operation from an unknown benefactor. The prisoner was given very specific instructions to infiltrate Site and maintain his position until further notice. The prisoner had enough samples of Dr. to stay within sight for days. Regrettably, the prisoner did not survive interrogation. Agent. Item number, SCP-040. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-040 is to be contained in a standard humanoid containment module within Bioresearch Area 12. The chamber is to be connected to an airborne tranquilizer dispersal system to be activated in the event of SCP-040 manifesting its properties outside of testing environments. The chamber is to be observed by two supervisory personnel at all times. Recreational items such as toys, games, and art supplies may be provided to SCP-040 at the discretion of supervisory personnel. As they have been determined to pose no possible threat, SCP-040-1A, SCP-040-1C, and SCP-040-1J have been approved to remain in the containment chamber with SCP-040 for purposes of the subject's mental well-being. Security Chief Special Order 392-5. All other entities modified by SCP-040 are to be disposed of after recovery and study, according to standard biological specimen clearance protocols, as outlined in Document CDP-BIOEN-1. No outside organisms are to be brought into SCP-040's presence beyond those used in testing procedures. SCP-040 is to undergo daily school lessons and bi-weekly psychological review, overseen by Drs. Habernathy, Logan, and Izawa. Description. SCP-040 is a Caucasian female of approximately 8 years of age, standing 1 meter in height. SCP-040 bears numerous physical abnormalities. The subject's skin is highly sensitive to light and easily damaged by physical contact, and the subject's hair is a bright pink in coloration. This hair is brittle and falls out easily. The subject displays green and yellow heterochromia, with the sclera of the left eye black in coloration. SCP-040 has no sight in this eye. SCP-040's emotional state is within acceptable boundaries for an individual of its age group, accounting for the effects of prolonged containment and physical abnormalities. Subject's intelligence is slightly above average for its age group, and displayed behavior is generally cooperative. Of note is SCP-040's quick acclimatization to containment, believed to be resultant of its upbringing before recovery. SCP-040 is capable of manipulating living matter, mutating and modifying existing organisms in order to create new ones, collectively referred to as SCP-040-1. This effect is at will, but requires significant focus and time to enact, and becomes increasingly unreliable and inaccurate when manipulating details through small-scale modifications. SCP-040 is incapable of altering microscopic organisms, and has great difficulty in altering plant life. Dead organic matter may also be used, but must be used in conjunction with a living organism. Instances of SCP-040-1 will not demonstrate pre-modification behavior. The majority will act similar to domesticated house pets, generally with extreme loyalty to SCP-040, regardless of prior association. The appearance of SCP-040-1 instances will vary. Some instances will retain overall pre-modification form with some alteration, such as SCP-040's apparent modification to itself, though the majority will bear no resemblance to their original appearances. SCP-040 appears incapable of manipulating instances of SCP-040-1 more than once. Recovery log. Subject was recovered on 2000 in. SCP-040 was one of 15 subjects taken into custody. Further investigation found no anomalous properties in any other individuals. Amnestics were administered to detainees and the general populace, and cover-up measures were enacted without further incident. Monitoring of the area is ongoing, in order to detect any resurgence of Addendum 1. SCP-040 is currently allowed custody of the following SCP-040-1 instances. SCP-040-1A, a polymorphic symbiotic organism, capable of changing size, shape, color, and texture in reaction to its environment. Subject serves as outer clothing, similar to a jacket or sweater, and absorbs nutrients from SCP-040's bloodstream. Subject was recovered alongside SCP-040, and genetic testing reveals that the subject shares the majority of its genetic makeup with the common house cat, Felis catus. SCP-040-1C, a spherical organism capable of flight by means of rubbery bladders filled with helium. Entity has 11 limbs terminating in opposable digits and a complex respiratory system capable of replicating a wide variety of musical patterns. SCP-040-1J, a quadrupedal organism covered in a thick coat of pink and blue fur. Entity has no eyes, a broad mouth with blunt teeth, and is capable of climbing up vertical surfaces. Occasionally used by SCP-040 as a mode of transportation. Addendum 2. The following excerpt is from an interview carried out on 2000, 3 weeks after initial containment. Dr. Abernathy. Good morning, 40. SCP-040. Good morning, Miss Abernathy. Dr. Abernathy. It's good to see that you're getting over your cold. SCP-040. Mm-hmm. Dr. Abernathy, can I ask you a few questions before we start with today's lesson? SCP-040. Yeah. Dr. Abernathy, can you tell me about your parents? SCP-040. Mr. Green said that I don't have any. Dr. Abernathy, can you tell me about Mr. Green then? SCP-040. He was nice, but he wasn't very good at talking. He would always talk like this, but he wasn't there a lot of the time. Most of the time, it was the nurses looking after us. Dr. Abernathy, and what did they do for you? SCP-040. They'd play games with us, and teach us things, and sometimes they would make us wear these dumb helmets and sit quiet for a long time. Sometimes they'd put a movie on for us if we behaved, but if we were bad, they would lock us in our rooms. Dr. Habernathy, can you tell me anything else? SCP-040. They always served us peas for dinner, and I hate peas, so I always gave mine to Five, because she liked peas, but I think green beans are better. Addendum 3, on 2000. SCP-040 successfully reanimated a deceased human body during testing, using three specimens of brown rat, Rattus norvegicus, as the required living component. Resultant subject retained no memories of previous life, and was judged to be of the approximate mental capacity of a human toddler. SCP-040 was highly distressed by the event, and refused further testing for the next 3 weeks. Item number, SCP-051. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. SCP-051 and SCP-051-A are to be kept in a sealed containment facility. SCP-051-A is kept within a locked, climate-controlled document box with a viewing window to prevent degradation of its material. Any personnel, with the exception of pregnant or non-sterile female personnel who might not be aware of an early-stage pregnancy, may access SCP-051 as long as a request is placed beforehand and cleared by site administration. Description. SCP-051 is a 25-centimeter, or 10-inch, anatomically correct model of a human female, carved out of ivory, with typically Asian features. Microscopic analysis shows that the head hair is human hair. The doll is jointed at the shoulders, hips, and knees. The stomach area of the doll is fully removable as a cap of ivory, exposing a detailed ribcage and organs, and a 2.5-centimeter or 1-inch ivory fetus, connected to the main figure by a leather cord umbilicus. When brought into the presence of a pregnant human female, SCP-051 has various deleterious effects upon the pregnancy, generally resulting in miscarriage of the fetus. Reports include a gentle compulsion to handle the model, open its stomach cap, and take out the fetus. This results in nausea and cramping within 5 minutes, vaginal bleeding that begins as spotting and may progress to hemorrhage within the next half hour, and miscarriage within 2 to 24 hours in most recorded cases. Medical records indicate that the aborted fetuses bear moderate to severe defects. Pregnancies carried to term after exposure to the model have resulted in severely deformed live births, including deaths of the mothers, and infants terminated after birth by the delivering physician. Witnesses to these live births show signs of severe emotional trauma that was alleviated, after Foundation interviews, by administration of a Class A amnestic. SCP-051-A is a fragment of text on rice paper that was discovered with SCP-051. The surviving text is written with plant-derived ink, test dated to the 12th century, and the characters have been identified as a known early dialect of Japanese. Translation reveals the text is part of a prayer or spell against demons that attack unborn babies. The incantation orders these forces or demons into the model instead of a pregnant woman, and claims to trap them there. However, centuries have degraded the paper and ink, so that the full incantation and instructions, if any, cannot be deciphered. SCP-051 and SCP-051-A were discovered in a box of early Japanese artifacts, delivered anonymously to the Museum in 1938. After 60 years and a number of incidents resulting from contact by female secretaries, researchers, and students, an agent on staff in the museum's archives learned of its properties and obtained it for Foundation study. Interview 051-1. Interviewed, Dr. David Ehrenfeld. Interviewer, Agent. Forward. Dr. Ehrenfeld was the attending physician at the death of Martha R. on January 2, 1942. This interview was conducted off-site, as Dr. Ehrenfeld was a resident of nursing facility. At the time of interview, he was 95 years old and physically infirm, though retaining most of his mental faculties. A Class A amnestic was administered after the interview. Begin log. Interviewer, thank you for seeing me, Doctor. Dr. Ehrenfeld, you are welcome. I have outlived most people who would care to hear such stories. Then again, they surely would have thought I was telling lies, or slipping into dementia. Now, you may think the same, but at my age, I do not care. Interviewer, Can you tell me what you remember of the events of January 2nd, 1942? Dr. Ehrenfeld, it was an ugly day. Cold and ugly. It can be a wonderful city sometimes, but winter is a bad season. It was late in the evening when my housekeeper told me I had been called. I was tired, but a birth is always a wonderful experience. I thought it would cheer me. I had a nurse with me, but the girl never came back to my office after that night. 15 minutes, perhaps, for the cab to reach the museum from my house? I'm not certain, but I think so. The doorman was waiting for me. He led me to the room where they had poor Mrs. R. laid out on a low table covered with some canvas ground cloths, I think, to make her more comfortable. Interviewer, what was her condition when you arrived? Dr. Ehrenfeld, thinking back now, I should have realized it was very bad. When I was young and had not much experience, she was quiet and only grunted with each contraction. She did not respond when I checked her vital signs and spoke to her. She did not even look at me. There was quite a bit of blood. A gush of it covered my hands as I reached down to begin helping her with the birth. The floor was slick with it underneath her, and the baby had not crowned yet. She was dilated well, and the contractions were quite close together, and this made me fear she may have been having a breech birth. I showed a calm face, though. I did not want to panic my nurse, or the researcher Dr. Merrill, who was nearby, a dignified older man. I believe I wanted to impress him. Interviewer, and then doctor? Dr. Ehrenfeld. I was concerned because of all the blood that her life was in danger. I told her to push, and she was pushing, and my nurse helped her, putting downward pressure on the abdomen as I attempted to manually aid the infant's emergence. I will spare you the details of a breech birth procedure. It can be found in any obstetrics manual of the time. I probed blindly and felt, well, I thought it was a coil of the umbilicus, perhaps tangled around the baby's neck. I almost withdrew, thinking that an episiotomy would be required. But she tore before I could proceed. There was more blood, and the baby began to emerge into my hands. I had never seen such a thing. You are a researcher. Do you know much of the common cephalic birth defects? This was uncommon. I thought at first the infant must be stillborn. Its flesh was gray, not the vernix-covered gray of a normal birth, but lifeless and degraded. The smell of decay. I recoiled, and the poor mother screamed on her last push, and the infant was delivered into my arms with a great rush of hemorrhage. The deformity. Unspeakable. The thoracic cavity was completely open. The limbs. Interviewer, but it wasn't a stillbirth. Dr. Ehrenfeld, it looked at me. I heard the nurse above me, beginning resuscitation attempts, then heard her gasp and falter as she saw what I held, gagging as the smell filled the room. I tried to drop the creature, but it clung to my hands. I felt my skin begin to blister and crack. Strange how clearly I can remember it. At my age, sometimes I cannot even remember what I had for dinner. The infant was almost double the length of a normal, viable fetus at 8 months. Its lower body, segmented. Interviewer, what did you do then? Dr. Ehrenfeld, it began to laugh, and I killed it. I broke its neck while it looked at me. Interviewer, were there ever any questions or consequences? Dr. Ehrenfeld, in 1942, with the country at war, and two respected professional men to give their testimony? No. The museum building had a furnace. I disposed of the infant's body myself. We claimed some more normal defect had taken the lives of mother and child. The husband was a drunkard, and cared for nothing but her life insurance policy. I believe he was drafted shortly thereafter, and died somewhere in France, and I left my practice almost immediately. I never delivered another child. End log. Closing statement. Dr. Ehrenfeld expired 4 months later of pneumonia. Item number, SCP-059. Object class, Keter. Special containment procedures. A single specimen of SCP-059 is kept at Site 11B inside a graded Z laminate shielding box composed of depleted uranium, tantalum, tin, steel, copper, and aluminum. Surrounding SCP-059's containment box is a 7 meter by 7 meter by 7 meter area, sealed as a level 4 biohazard area, and surrounded by 3 centimeters of lead shielding. This area is to be sprayed daily with a solution of methyl isothiocyanate to prevent overgrowth of SCP-059-1. Personnel entering an SCP-059 affected area are cautioned to wear appropriate biohazard protection, as well as type K-59-B radiation shielding. They are to remain in the area for no more than 15 minutes, as the radiation shielding is only partially effective. SCP-059-1 infestations found in the wild should be contained by removing the SCP-059 specimen responsible and incineration of all observed SCP-059-1. Large underground infestations are best neutralized by fuel-air thermobaric explosives. Additional specimens of SCP-059 are not needed for experimentation and should be transported to Site 11B for incineration by plasma arc at 10,000 Kelvin. Description: SCP-059 is a radioactive mineral of unknown origin, superficially resembling scheelite. A component of SCP-059 is believed to originate in an alternate universe, and to be responsible for its anomalous properties. In addition to alpha, beta, and gamma radiation, SCP-059 specimens produce a previously unknown type of radiation, apparently unique to the object, tentatively designated delta radiation. Delta radiation is accompanied by Cherenkov radiation, visible as a blue glow. Delta radiation is only partially contained by standard radiation shielding. The best results have been obtained using grade Z laminate shielding with an additional super dense metal layer. This reduces the effective range of delta radiation from approximately 20 meters to approximately 6 meters. When an area is exposed to delta radiation for more than 15 minutes, an unknown species of fungus, designated SCP-059-1, begins to grow on any exposed surface. This fungus does not require any standard nutrition, but will die within 24 hours of removal from a delta radiation source. SCP-059-1 is itself radioactive, but does not emit delta radiation. However, if a critical mass of SCP-051-1 is allowed to grow, delta radiation from an unknown source other than SCP-059 will appear in the area, further supporting SCP-059-1's growth. Interested readers may consult Dr. for his theories of space-time stress and merger of alternate realities. Within 18 hours, the infected mass will become transparent and disappear, presumably into the universe that is the source of delta radiation. The process then continues, with SCP-059-1 infecting new material. SCP-059-1 will infest both living beings and inanimate objects. Humans and animals infected with SCP-059-1 become immune to the effects of ionizing radiation, but progressively merge with SCP-059-1, and eventually have all tissues replaced by fungal growth. While generally non-violent, they will attempt to expose unaffected individuals to SCP-059. SCP-059-1 infections do not appear to be directly contagious, but only spread by contact with delta radiation. However, long-term exposure to SCP-059-1 has not been adequately tested to rule out considering it a biohazard, as well as a known radiation hazard. Infected individuals still capable of communication describe seeing a world entirely covered with SCP-059-1, where much of the surface is composed of SCP-059. It is unclear whether this is a hallucination or a view into the source of SCP-059. Infectees are generally pleased with their condition and often refer to being in the blue light of heaven. SCP-059-1 is affected by most fungicides, but new growth will continue as long as SCP-059 is present. Early stage SCP-059-1 infection in humans may be treated with griseofulvin. However, the treatment is 90% likely to lead to death by radiation poisoning. Treated individuals lose their immunity to radiation and will already have absorbed a now lethal dose prior to treatment. Late stage treatment should not be attempted, as too much tissue will already be converted to SCP-059-1. The remains of failed treatments should be kept out of range of SCP-059. Otherwise, data expunged. SCP-059 specimens have been discovered in 8 different underground locations across a range of 5,000 kilometers. No pattern has emerged for their appearance. Specimens range from 1 to 10 kilograms in size and are not part of the normal rock formations in the areas where they have been found. Addendum: Dr. has recorded and analyzed the patterns of radiation emitted by the contained SCP-059-1 colony, and believes SCP-059-1 may be sapient and attempting to communicate via controlled emissions of radiation. Initial attempts to analyze this language reveal data expunged. Item number, SCP-065. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. As SCP-065 cannot be moved, it has been contained on site, and site has been established around it. Said site has been marked as a government research facility, off limits to civilians, and unauthorized individuals attempting to gain access to the area are to be detained, questioned, and administered a Class A amnestic if deemed necessary by site security. An area 17 meters in radius around the center of SCP-065 has been designated the Red Zone. Personnel may not enter the Red Zone of SCP-065 at any time, and experimentation with SCP-065 may only be performed with prior approval from at least two Level 3 senior research staff. Personnel at high risk of cancer must not be assigned to site, and all site personnel must undergo mandatory monthly physical evaluations, including cancer screenings. Description: SCP-065 is a spherical region of space, approximately 12 meters in radius, located on a farm near an undisclosed location. SCP-065 was formed by the destruction of an anomalous artifact on site by the Global Occult Coalition. Immediately following this initial event, the radius of SCP-065 was estimated to have initially expanded to 108 meters in radius, resulting in the deaths of 11 GOC operatives and 5 civilians. Since containment by the Foundation, the effective radius of SCP-065 has shrunk to and remained stable at its current size. SCP-065 causes abnormal transfiguration of any living organism within its area of effect. These effects include, but are not limited to, regression of specialized cells to an undifferentiated stem state, spontaneous separation and fusion of undifferentiated cells, spontaneous necrosis of living tissue and reanimation of dead tissue, rapid genetic mutation of living tissue. These effects occur at a rate proportional to the mass and complexity of the organism. Plants and insects show few, if any, effects. Small animals will exhibit alterations following several days of exposure. Larger animals will show harmful mutations within hours. And all human subjects exposed to the Red Zone have been fatally altered within approximately 15 minutes of exposure. To date, all attempts at directly observing the center of SCP-065 have failed, as SCP-065 causes a form of extreme sensory confusion in all observers that extends to recording equipment. Affected personnel have reported highly distorted vision and hearing that persists for several hours and can result in severe dizziness and nausea. Addendum 065-1, Researcher Note. On a robotic rover designed to use somatosensory rather than visual or acoustic navigation, managed to reach the center of SCP-065 and retrieve several objects. When pieced back together, these objects appeared to be the shattered fragments of a stone figurine of Kokopelli, a Native American fertility deity. Along with pre-incident data, obtained from the Global Occult Coalition, it appears that this artifact has been used by the civilian family to boost the yield of their farm, and only came to the attention of the GOC when an investigation by the United States Department of Agriculture revealed genetic markers in their supposed organic crops, consistent with those of genetically modified organism, or GMO, crops. The GOC attempted an on-site destruction of this artifact, resulting in the creation of SCP-065. Following this incident, the GOC contacted a Foundation liaison and requested assistance in containing the resultant anomaly. Addendum 065-2. The following document was recovered from the formerly civilian-owned farmhouse at site. John, I heard things aren't going so well back at home. I wish I could come back and help right now, but it's tough over here right now as well, and we're on the verge of some important discoveries. I know it's not much, but I found this during the trip. The man who gave it to me described it as a representation of that which is and that which might be. Planted by the cornfield, and hopefully it will help make ends meet. See you soon, G. Item number, SCP-113. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. SCP-113 is to be kept in standard storage in Site-23. SCP-113 may be handled with laboratory gloves. No organism may be exposed to SCP-113 without prior approval. Personnel exposed to SCP-113 are to be kept under medical observation for 7 days. Description: SCP-113 resembles a small, polished piece of red jasper. Analysis shows that SCP-113 is not composed of jasper, but composition similar to that of other recovered objects. When SCP-113 comes in direct contact with the flesh of an organism possessing sex chromosomes, the organism's physical characteristics associated with gender and biological sex are transformed, including genetics and secondary sexual characteristics, either reversed or altered. This process occurs in 4 stages. Stage 1 lasts approximately 0.2 seconds. SCP-113 bonds with the cells that it touches and induces an unidentified chemical change. This process causes tissue damage similar to mild burns, and SCP-113 cannot be removed from contact with the subject until all stages complete. Stage 2 lasts approximately 20 seconds. SCP-113 emits a low-intensity electromagnetic wave which travels through the subject's body. Subjects may experience nausea and vomiting, along with a stinging sensation throughout the body. Stage 3 lasts approximately 60 seconds. Throughout this stage, the subject's cellular makeup is temporarily transformed. Altered cell composition ranges widely from being unidentifiable as human to a unique variation of partially differentiated stem cells. The subject will experience intense stimulation of all sensory nerves during the final 20 seconds of this stage, and describe this part of the process as extremely painful. Subjects in poor health may die of shock in this stage. At the end of this stage, the subject's biological sex is permanently altered. In standard cases, the subject's biological sex will be changed to the opposite biological sex. All primary and secondary sexual characteristics are altered accordingly. Stage 4. SCP-113 disengages from the subject and becomes inert. Subjects with sex chromosomes atypical for their species, such as intersex humans, are affected in unpredictable ways by SCP-113. In human intersex subjects, this appears to be influenced by gender identity. Such subjects may be unaffected, or their bodies may change to match baseline male or female bodies, with sex chromosomes to match, or other results may occur. Usually, change seems to match or partially match subjects' gender identity during initial use, if gender identity is non-standard. Whether SCP-113 alters its effect based on the presence of a non-standard gender identity is under investigation. Gender identity of human subjects is not typically altered by SCP-113. In subjects with non-standard gender identities, typically gender identities which do not match their pre-exposure biological sex, this usually results in positive psychological effects. In subjects with standard gender identities, male and female, matching pre-exposure biological sex, psychological effects are usually negative. These appear to be natural psychological reactions, and not an anomalous effect of SCP-113. SCP-113 exposure results in unusual effects in certain species. In Varanus komodoensis, the Komodo dragon, a number of ZWZZ individuals were transformed to possess WW chromosomes instead of ZZ or ZW, which was, in every instance, fatal. In Caenorhabditis elegans, a nematode, no males were produced, despite C. elegans having 2 sexes, hermaphrodite and male. Male subjects became hermaphrodites, and hermaphrodite subjects were unaffected. Note: in wild populations, male C. elegans are extremely rare. Subjects of single-sex hermaphroditic species, such as earthworms, will not be transformed by SCP-113. The object's process will stop at the 2nd stage, and the object will become inert. Previously exposed subjects may undergo SCP-113's effects again by reinitiating contact with SCP-113 after approximately 60 seconds have passed. However, in 25% of cases, immediate second exposure to SCP-113 fails to transform the subject correctly. Transformation failure varies in nature, but usually includes massive bone, organ, and tissue damage to the subject, as well as partial or complete obliteration of genitalia. This commonly results in death by organ trauma or internal bleeding. Failure rate can be affected by subjects not coming into contact with SCP-113 for a lengthy period of time, which varies by subject. Patterns are under research. Under normal circumstances, transformation failure rate increases exponentially upon multiple exposures. Subjects who survive rapid, repeated exposure are eventually transformed, data expunged. Further anomalous elements continue to appear as exposure count increases. Lesson complete. To continue with your orientation training, subscribe to SCP Orientation right now, and make sure you don't miss any of our upcoming videos.